guys. It's Boxing Gossip here. Delighted to be joined on the channel by heavyweight contender Ian Lewiston. Ian, thanks very much for your time today, mate. Could you tell us a little bit about what's going on with you at the minute?
Well, at the minute, I'm just training. I'm just trying to get my body in good shape to come back, to bounce back from my last fight, and just trying to get good again.
Absolutely. So, Dillian White fight now must be 5-6 months ago. Have you been in the gym pretty consistently since that previous fight?
Yeah, I've been, yeah, because the circumstances around it weren't ideal, and it's like I wasn't in the best of shape I could have been for it. I'm actually in better shape now than I was for the fight.
Definitely. Is that one of the things that you've taken from that fight? I mean, I think you were brought in at fairly late notice, if memory serves. So is it kind of a stay ready approach now, because you never know when the phone's going to ring?
Yeah, that's definitely an approach that that's definitely something I've taken from that fight, because you never know when something is going to be thrusted upon you. So it's like it's better you stay hard prepared than when something is given to you, feel like you need another 8 weeks to get ready for it, because circumstances aren't always ideal and you won't always get the 8 weeks to prepare for it.
Of course. Ian, I wanted to ask you about that Dillian White fight. Yeah, obviously the fight didn't necessarily end in the result you were hoping for, but my perception is it's kind of raised your name and public profile, and because you put on a pretty admirable performance in that fight, it's almost, you know, despite the fact it ended in a loss, it's almost been a positive. You know, is that the correct way of looking at it, or for you is it, you know, is it not something you look back at with fondness because of the loss?
Well, me personally, I genuinely don't see any positives in it, because I didn't win it, so I don't see any positives in it. The only positive that was in it was that he didn't stop me.
Yeah.
And truth be told is I wasn't in the best of shape. That was like a 40% me coming in there. And for me being 40% and him being at 100%, because he's coming off the back of two training camps, two fights beforehand, where he's been in two training camps back to back. He knew the date beforehand of the date that he was going to fight on that fight. So he knew prior 8-9 weeks before that he was going to fight, but he just never knew it was me. So he had something to train towards. So he came in 100%, where I came in 40%. And the truth be told is me at 40% against him at 100%, it was still a pretty competitive fight. Mm. So it weren't like I went in there and he totally outclassed me or anything like that. It was never the case. So it goes to show, if I'm only 40% and it was still a pretty even fight, imagine I was 100%.
Of course. Is that a fight you'd like again in the future, Ian?
No, 100%, if that fight could be made again, but I doubt he would want it. But if it could be made again and I went into it 100%, you'd definitely see a different result and a different type of fight.
I'll move on from Dillian White, but just before I do, one final question on that. Like, how do you rate his power? You know, obviously you held up to it really well in that fight. Is he a big hitter as far as you're concerned?
Throughout the fight, you'll see it yourself, and it's evident. Yeah, he hit me clean so many times. Never at one point in time did you see me take a backward step when he hit me.
Mm.
You never saw me take a backward step, and the truth be told is he hit me clean. I gave him opportunities to hit me to try and draw him in to fight me so I could get in range to hit him, but he still couldn't put me on the back foot.
Definitely. So was he not as big a hitter as you were potentially expecting, and as some of the rumours about him?
No, but I've always said it and I've always known it that he weren't a big puncher. Alright, let's look at it for his record now, yeah? Let's go through and look at it. How many stoppages has he got to how many wins? Look at his fight, how many stoppages has he got?
I'm just pulling him up now, Ian. Bear with me for 1 second. I think he's got like a fairly high ratio of KOs, just based on... he's got 20 wins, 15 KOs. So of his wins, right, 75% knockout ratio.
Now I'm going to ask you this then, yeah?
Yeah.
Out of them 15 wins that he's got, which are stoppages, yeah?
Yeah.
How many of them has he hit the person once and the person's gone down and the person's not been able to go up? Or has it been a case of him hitting a person once or twice and then catch the person getting bombarded with shots and the referee jumping in and stopping the fight?
Yeah, I think as he stepped up in level, that's certainly been the case here, definitely.
Well, there you go. That shows he's not a puncher, because if he was a puncher, he would have hit them, and the person who wants to continue just couldn't. Their body just couldn't physically do it. So if it's a case of him hitting them and then bombarding them with shots, that's technically, that's a stoppage. That's not a knockout. So it goes to show that he's not a big puncher.
Okay. No, I hear what you're saying there, and definitely, I think your fight with him and possibly Dave Allen's fight with him as well are kind of fights that have, you know, given the public some, because I think everyone saw him hit Joshua, you know, in the Joshua fight and hurt Joshua, and I think because he had a high knockout ratio, because he's been fighting a lower level of opponents, and then that fight he kind of developed this reputation. But do you think your fight and maybe Dave Allen's fight and some of the more recent matchups have kind of exposed that?
Yeah, but I think, do you know what, my explanation for the Joshua one, yeah?
Yeah.
I genuinely think in the build-up towards the Joshua fight now, yeah, Joshua allowed him to get personal and it allowed him to get on his nerve. He allowed him to get emotionally involved in it, yeah? And because Joshua was emotionally involved in it now, yeah, he never took to the fight with his professional approach like how he would, and there was emotions involved in it. And when you go into a fight with emotions, yeah, when you get hit, the punches tend to hurt more than they would have if you went in there with your normal boxing brain, because you get careless and you do silly things. And I think it was a case of where Joshua was so emotionally involved in the fight that the nervous energy of everything, like on the night and everything, because of the previous history, the fact that he had fought him before and he stopped him, there was so much, his emotions were all over the place. So in the fight, he got hit. And because of the whole event, the whole day, the whole night, everything that, the emotions and everything, that punch had a bigger effect on him than it would have normally. And I put it down to a case of that, because I don't genuinely see how he could hit Joshua and hurt Joshua, like, and him being the puncher he is. But as it's, well, that being said, true and all, when two big heavyweights hit each other, the possibility is always there to knock the other one out. But I genuinely think it came down to the fact of the nerves on the night.
That makes sense, yeah. You mentioned the sort of bad blood between those two. Do you feel there was an element of that in your fight with Dillian, obviously being from the same part of London, and there was a bit of heat in the build-up, I guess?
No, do you know what? I generally don't think I have no bad blood towards him. I just think the guy's a bit of an idiot. I just think he just gets personal and he just talks a lot, but I don't have no animosity towards him. I just think he's very intrusive about, there's a professional mannerism in which you do things when you're going out on a fight zone. There's a way you approach things, you can talk to people, and it's like, if I'm in a press conference with you and I'm fighting you, it's okay for me to talk about you, but it's not okay for me to talk about your family, because you just don't do that, because you're fighting me, you're not fighting my family. So why would you bring other aspects of my life into it? And I think he gets too personal.
Do you think that could be a bit of a flaw for him throughout his career? Do you think that will find him out as he continues to be involved in these big fights?
I don't know if it's a... I think there's two reasons for it. To one being, it gets the other person that he's fighting emotionally involved and it allows them to drop their professional head about it. And two, I think he does it because he knows that he's under the impression any press is good press. So I think there's two ways in which I'm looking on it.
I hear you. No, I see where you're coming from there, Ian. Moving on from Dillian White, there's been lots of talks about potential fights that you could be involved with following on from that matchup. Is your intention now to go straight into another big fight with a recognised name, or do you want to kind of have a comeback fight before maybe a 4-rounder or a 6-rounder? What's your perspective on that?
Man, I genuinely don't care. I'll fight tomorrow if it's Dave Allen or it's another warm-up fight. To me, it don't matter. A fight is a fight. It makes no difference if I have a warm-up one. It makes no difference if I have a straight another fight again with someone of David Allen's level. It makes no difference to me.
David Allen's certainly the name that I hear you being linked with more regularly than some of the other guys in the division. What's your take on that? Do you think that's your most likely next fight, Ian?
No, I think so, definitely. I think that fight's going to happen. It's a fight that people want to see and it will happen.
Yeah, I had Dave Allen on the channel yesterday, actually, and we were discussing his next moves, and that fight came up, potentially with it being on the undercard of Kell Brook versus Errol Spence at Bramall Lane. for some sort of title. So, you know, clearly that would be a fairly large event and, you know, a great one to be involved with. What sort of approach would you take? Like, what sort of vulnerabilities do you see in Dave? And, you know, what would you look to do in the ring in order to get a nod over him?
No, the truth is, David, he's a good fighter, but he's lacking experience because I don't think he fought at a high level as an amateur. And as a pro, he's just finding his feet now because he's had a few wins. He got thrown in there with King Kong. He got thrown in there with Dillon, so he's got two losses. But there's no shame in that because the people he lost to were good. But I just think his boxing experience, he's learning every day and he's obviously getting better as time goes on because he's showing, it's evident. He's got two stoppages back-to-back now. No disrespect to David. I genuinely think he's a good fighter, but I genuinely think he's inexperienced. And I think that's what will be the difference between us two fighting.
Do you think that you'd have an advantage on Dave Allen on the boxing side and on the power side, Ian?
Yeah, definitely. I think so. I think on the power side, yeah, on the power, definitely nothing like, there's no comparison. They are definitely more explosive than he is. I'm the bigger puncher out of the two. And the boxing ability, I think, I'm able to adapt more in fights than he is. But I can box or I can fight, but the difference is I choose to fight. That's why I fight. It's not a case of me fighting because that's the only way I know how to do. I can box when I need to. And if anyone who's watched me fight before knows, they can see it in the Dorian Dutch fight when I fought him. At some times I boxed him, sometimes I fought him. When I fought him, it was down to whatever I felt worked for me at the time. So I went between the two, boxing, fighting, countering. I went between it all. And I think that's probably the approach that I'd have with David as well. It wouldn't be a case of me going out there and rushing him. I'll deal with what David comes at me with. If David boxes me, I'll fight him. If he wants to fight me, I'll box him. I'll adapt to whatever he's bringing.
When I spoke to Dave about it yesterday, his perspective was that you would be a very, very tough opponent, certainly in the first half of the fight. And he kind of gave me the impression that his target would be to get to the middle of the fight, just being in it, you know, being competitive, maybe even you with a slight lead. His viewpoint was that he'd be able to take over the fight in the second half. You know, he believes that he'd have an edge in fitness and he'd maybe be able to wear you down in the second half of the fight, Ian. So what's your take on that?
My take on that is this famous Mike Tyson quote, everyone has a plan until they get hit. And the truth be told is, yeah, half of the fights, or not even half of the fights, all of the fights where I went in and I stopped guys early, yeah, they were all under that same way of thinking, oh, we're just going to ride the weather and take over in the second half of the fight. But what they think I'm going to do, they think I'm going to stand there shadow box for the first half of the fight and allow them to just hit me while I punch air. The truth of the matter is, they're saying I got to get through. They're going to allow me to box or whatever. But the truth is, they're in there with me. They got to get through the first half to get to the second half. And that's the challenge in itself. Because I'm not going to be shadow boxing the air for the first half of the fight.
Definitely, definitely. I think Dave Allen is probably most known to you know, supporters of UK boxing. Well, maybe most known is incorrect, but he's certainly very well known for having a chin. You know, he's shown an excellent chin against King Kong and against you know, Dillian White. Do you think you've got the power necessarily to end that record and put him on the floor, Ian?
No, definitely. Do you know what? I've got the power to test his chin. I will be the man that tests him. I'm not saying I'll knock him out, I'm not saying I won't knock him out, but what I'm saying to you is, we'll see and we'll definitely gauge how good David's chin is in the fight with me.
I completely see what you mean, yeah. Dave was saying that after that fight, the logical next matchup for the winner of you versus Dave Allen would be fighting for the British title against the winner of Gary Cornish and Sam Sexton. Is that a route that you're interested in, and what do you make of that matchup?
Yeah, it's ridiculous that Gary Cornish, and I can understand it from a point of view being that the two of them are fighters, but to me, the two of them, it's not a fight that really interests me, like, personally, like the Dave Allen one does. That gets me going, and I see, because, alright, do you know from a boxer's point of view, yeah? In order for me, or this is from my point of view, in order for me to get up for a fight, I genuinely have to feel some sort of fear in right. The sense that I think the person's going to bring something to me to get me up for a fight, and that motivates me and allows me to train for the fight. But if I don't feel that the person is bringing much towards the table, I tend to, what I've realised in the past is, I tend to not take it how I should do, and then them fights end up being the long, drawn-out ones. But with someone like David now, because I know David's up for it and he's going to bring it, I'll be on my A game, so I know it's going to be a good fight because I'm motivated to train and to get the rounds in beforehand and do everything that needs to be done to get the win. But with someone like Cornish or Sexton now, I don't genuinely think they can bring anything that can hurt me.
Yeah. I certainly agree that, and I think most fans would agree that a fight between yourself and David Allen is a bigger, more exciting fight than Cornish v Sexton. Would you be motivated by the opportunity to win a British title against the winner of that fight, or are you kind of at a stage where, you know, the belt itself isn't a pure motivator? In?
No, of course the belt is a motivator, but the fact of the matter is, what motivates me is the fight itself. It's not necessarily the belt. Obviously, the belt is a reward that's shown for your efforts, but with me, it's the fight itself that motivates me.
I understand completely. Yeah. Okay. No, that makes sense. So, if you were to fight Dave Allen on that Kell Brook undercard, and obviously hoping you'll be successful in that, what would be the fights that you'd be really looking at and targeting after that? Do you have a route in mind, or, you know, opponents or titles in mind?
I'd like to fight the guy. What's his name? The European champion. Because I think stylistically, I think that would be a good fight as well. The one that Chisora fought and lost to. I can't remember his name.
Oh, Kubrat Pulev.
That's it, yeah.
Yeah.
I think stylistically that'll make for a good fight as well.
Yeah, he's got a fight now, actually. I'm just trying to remember who it is. He's fighting Kevin Johnson.
Kevin Johnson, isn't it?
Yeah, that's a strange fight, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Especially being that Kevin Johnson's American and he's European champion.
Yeah, and Pulev fought Samuel Peter before that, didn't he? That was another sort of pretty bizarre...
Oh, did he fight Samuel Peter?
Yeah, he bought Samuel Peter out of retirement, you know... Like, Peter was in pretty terrible condition, but yeah, so it's kind of odd with Pulev because, like, you know, he got offered the Joshua fight and didn't seem to want it, and he hasn't really, you know, stepped up again. He's kind of a bit in limbo, so no, that would be a good fight, definitely. You mentioned Chisora. Are you still training with Derek? So I hear he's...
I don't train with Derek, I train with Don. What happens is, what it is that me and Derek have the same trainer. We're not training buddies, we're not training partners or anything.
Right.
We train with the same trainer.
Okay. So you kind of cross paths a bit more, perhaps?
Yeah, we'll see each other on our way in or out of the gym, but that's about as far as our relationship does.
Understood. Okay. Because I saw that he had a big fight announced, a rematch with Robert Hellenius. Yeah. Do you have an instinct on that matchup?
Whoever wins, to me, it phases. I'm not phased by whoever wins. Whichever one wins. Good luck to him. I don't really care.
Would you ever fight Chisora? Would that be too difficult because of your relationship with Don?
No, listen, at the end of the day, if it makes financial sense, it makes sense. But then, regardless of anything, if it was a case of him having a belt and then I'm being eligible for the belt, I'm not going to not fight him just for the fact that we share the same trainer.
Right.
By all means, I'll fight him.
Okay, it kind of comes down to the commercials and the finances, I guess, fight of that nature. Okay, no, that makes sense. Looking at the world title scene, Ian, obviously you've got two big matchups in the pipeline at present. Huey Fury versus Joseph Parker out in New Zealand and Joshua versus Vladimir Klitschko.
What's your opinion on that fight, the Huey Fury versus Parker?
I'm actually picking Huey Fury in that one. I'm a big...
Yeah?
I am. I'm a big fan of both guys. I like both guys. I rate them both very highly. Joseph Parker, I've been a bit unconvinced by his boxing as he stepped up in levels. I think he's defensively open. I don't think he commits to his jab enough. I think he can be countered. And I think he might struggle against a guy who's taller than him and can move.
So you reckon, even with the fact that Fury ain't going to have his dad in his corner, he'll still win?
Peter Fury's got a visa now.
Oh, he's got one?
Yeah, he's got a special exemption. My biggest concern about Huey Fury, actually, is the... Funnily enough, I spoke about this with Dave yesterday as well, but it's the ring rust. You know, he's been out of the ring now. He'll be out of the ring for, you know, over 12 months, stepping straight up into the biggest fight of his career. It's not... He hasn't got the best momentum, but I think Parker's got an edge in power, and Parker's got an edge in athleticism, but I think Huey's probably got an edge in terms of... skills and technique.
But sometimes, what I understand what you're saying about the ring rust, but sometimes the rest can do you good, especially when you've been really active for such a long space of time as well.
I see what you mean. It kind of, I guess there's pros and cons, isn't there?
No, of course, yeah, because if you've been active for the last 3-4 years fighting every 3 months, and it's been a thing where you've constantly done it, the rest could have been what the body needed. Ideally, he could have been feeling a bit burnt out. That's why he hasn't fought in such a long time. And right now, he's starting to feel reinvigorated and re-energized again. So the rest, who knows, the rest could have done him good.
Are you picking Parker in that one then, based on what you were saying a second ago, or do you think Huey could spring the upset?
I'd have to side with Parker.
Okay, do you rate Parker in general? Do you?
Tell you the truth, I've watched like glimpses. I don't really watch him. I've never really watched him. I've just watched the bits of his fight. But then I remember one time I did watch Huey Fury when he fought on Channel 5, and he fought I can't remember the guy's name, but it was potentially one of the worst fights I saw.
Oh, right, was it? Okay. Was it Dominic Gwynn?
No, it wasn't Gwynn. It was a British guy.
Danny Hughes?
Hughes, that's it, yeah.
Yeah, no, I hear you. Parker's obviously performed at a higher level, hasn't he, I guess, with Takam and Ruiz and those sort of guys. What about Klitschko Joshua, Ian? Is that one you're getting excited for?
No, definitely. That's definitely a fight to look forward to. That's equivalent. That's a super fight. That's like a big fight out there, isn't it?
Yeah. I think it's probably the biggest fight there is at the minute. Definitely.
Yeah, definitely. Right now, that's the biggest fight out there. So yeah, that's definitely a fight that gets people's mouth watering. Yeah.
Yeah. Do you have a strong instinct to one fight or the other there?
My thing on that fight, yeah, it comes to, I don't know, because to me it depends, because I generally don't think Joshua has been hit and hurt in a fight, yeah?
Yeah.
And had to come back from that and pull it out of the bag. And Klitschko now, I don't know if he's got the desire inside him to get hit and hurt and to turn it around after that to come back from it. So that's what I'm in the belief of right now. I don't know, so I'm tilting between the two. Because if Klitschko is still at the stage in his career where he's young and he's hungry in his mind frame, and he'll get hit and hurt and come back and have the desire to still win, then yeah, I'll give it to Klitschko. And if Joshua can get hit and hurt and get that out of his mind and then still come back with the desire to win, then I'll give it to Joshua. But I'm kind of torn between the two. But if I had to choose one, I'll choose Klitschko.
Right. Going with the experience then.
Yeah, I just think, yeah, because of the fact that I don't genuinely think Joshua's had to deal with being hit and hurt before.
Have you sparred with any of these guys, Ian, over the years?
Yeah, I've sparred with Joshua a few times, yeah.
Okay, how do you rate Joshua's power?
And I've said this many a time, and I've said this time and time again, yeah. Joshua himself isn't a big one puncher.
Okay.
He's not a big one puncher. And what it is with Joshua, yeah, he's so quick and he's so precise that he'll hit you once. And then when you're hurt from that first hit, by the time your brain's registered that you're hurt, he's hit you another 5-6 times. He's like, bah, 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 bah. He's back on you again. And that's what it is with Joshua. He doesn't give you time. He just hits you fast as a shot, bap, and then he'll come back on you again, bap, 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 bap. And then that's what it is with Joshua. You just don't realise that you've been hit with 10 shots.
There's a lot of rumours about Joshua's punch resistance. Obviously, there's like the famous rumour he got knocked out by David Price. There's been a few more recent rumours that he's been hurt in sparring by the likes of Lawrence Sokoli and other names as well. Have you do you buy into this, or do you kind of think it's it's just chit chat, Ian?
No, but the truth of the matter is, look at Marvin Hagler. He's never been down on the floor in a fight before, but he got dropped in sparring.
Yeah,
it makes no difference, because sparring, yeah, is the biggest representation you can get of a fight, yeah. And what you're doing in sparring is learning your craft, and in sparring you're doing what you're not comfortable at doing. You're learning new things. So if you, for example, you're an orthodox and you want to learn to box southpaw, you'll go southpaw in sparring and you'll try it. And obviously, because it's new to you, you're going to get hit and you're going to get caught. And when you're getting hit by a guy who's 18 stone or 19 stone or whatever it is, you'll get hurt. So I'm not buying into all that, because the truth be told is, if you're trying things and you're going to get hit and hurt, you'll get, anyone can get hurt. It's just a matter of hitting them at where, at what point in time. So the truth be told is, anyone can get hurt. But on fight night, he's not going to practice stuff. He's going to do what he knows he can do and do it comfortably.
Yeah, I see what you mean. I see what you mean. So, you know, against a guy like Vladimir Klitschko, do you think we'll see a normal Anthony Joshua, you know, a guy who looks to come out and establish himself and take an early lead, or do you think we'll see him be a little bit more tentative and respectful of Klitschko's power?
I think so, definitely. He'll be a bit more... to tell you the truth, I don't think he'll be tentative, because he's confident. He just won... He's a world champion. He's got the confidence of being world champion. He knows that he's the man of the moment. As much as he admires Klitschko, he genuinely believes that he is the real deal. So therefore, knowing all of that in mind, I don't think he'll come out being tentative. I think he'll come out to assert himself, because he's obviously watched Klitschko fights where Klitschko lost to Corey Sanders, and he lost to, what's the other guy's name? Brewer and all them guys.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Them guys
yeah.
had to go through hell to beat him. They got the win or whatever, but they got put it on them first. So what I think he'll do is jump on him, because he knows that Klitschko's chin isn't the greatest.
Interesting, yeah. It's certainly one to look forward to. You know, I'm buzzing for that fight, definitely. Ian, really appreciate you taking the time to speak to me today and for coming on. What I'm going to do is upload this this afternoon, and I'll send you a link on your social media so you can have a look at it if you want. But yeah, is there anything more you got, Ian? Anything else to add?
Yeah,
or?
I just wanted to add my sponsors on there. Yeah.
Yeah, go for it. Yeah.
Alright, thanks. I just want to thank my sponsors, Adidas and Cymax and RVL Free Security and Pro Games Mills and ASICS Trainers. I want to thank all of them for their help.
Nice one.
Yeah, thanks.
Nice one. Cheers, mate. No, appreciate it, Ian. Thanks very much indeed for coming on, and hope to catch up with you again in future.
Alright, cheers, mate.
All the best, Ian. Bye now. Bye.